Yes, Arati, please introduce yourself. Tell us where you're telling from, and please tell us a story.
Right. Thank you so much, Eric. This is my debut here. So I'm nervous, but thankfully we have our cameras off. So I'm like a little relaxed. Good for me. Well, my name is Aditi Mangal. I am based out of New Delhi, India. I do storytelling for children from the age 2 years to about 10 years. And I run my own initiative, storytelling initiative, by the name of Enablify India. You can find me on Facebook, Enablify India, where I do a lot of work with children through storytelling and imbibing education, learning through education through stories. We play a lot of games, interactive activities, and the like. I don't usually do a lot of adult storytelling, so that's why I think this is my debut here. I know a few people here, so I'm so glad that I know Simi and Manisha, yes, and Usha, ma'am. So I'm so glad you're there. So it's really comforting. So this is going to be the life story of me, how I became a storyteller. And from a very shy, introvert, a quiet, convent-educated, girly, and becoming a storyteller now. So once upon a time, there was this little girl. She loved things around her. She was very observant, but she was very quiet. Yes, that's me. You can see me blabbering now, but that wasn't the case 43 years back. Oops, that tells you my age though, but that's all right. I come from a big joint family with lots of uncles and aunts, my grandparents, my great-grandparents. And when you have a big family in India, in Delhi, stories are a part of you. You grow stories, you live in stories. Stories are all around you. And my first brush with stories started when we had our festivals. Because in India, and especially from the house that I come from, every festival has a story. Every god has a story. To the extent I love story, hearing these stories from my grandmother so much that by the time I grew up a little bit, I wanted to marry each god. I was so fascinated by each of them. So I wanted to marry Ganesha. I wanted to marry Rama when I heard a story for Diwali. And I was so much in awe with all of them. So I would pester my grandmom. I call her Amma. Amma, which is grandmother, paternal grandmother. And I would say, Dadi, Dadi, Amma, Amma, tell me a story. Why is Ganesha eating? Why do we celebrate Ganesh Chaturthi? And she would start on with a story that Ganesha went over with a handful of rice and milk. He went over the entire village asking anybody to make a pudding out of it. Everybody started laughing. Oh, who can make a pudding out of a handful of rice grains and a little bit of milk? Just then, there was an old lady, and she was really concerned. She said, Ganeshya, oh Ganeshya, aja beta, come here. I can make it for you, but you have to wait. Amma, it's okay, Dadi, just make it for me. I'm very, very hungry, you know. So the old lady took the handful of rice, grains of rice, and the milk, mixed it together, added some sugar, stirred and stirred and stirred. And to her dismay, the little handful of rice and milk and sugar just started to boil, 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 and it came out of the pot. From one pot to the other, and other, and other, the rice pudding started overflowing. She did not have enough utensils to put the pudding into him. Then she realized, she turned towards Ganesha and she said, Ganesha, wait a minute. Can I serve this pudding to you? Ganesha said, I'm going to take a bath and come back. Just wait. He went. In the meanwhile, the daughter-in-law of the old lady, she wanted to taste this magical pudding, which was smelling nice and was over, the smell had just overfilled, the aroma had overfilled the entire house. So just then when she took a taste of it, she thought, oh, this is yum. And she started taking one bite after another, almost managed to finish the one whole potful. Ganesha comes back. Now the old lady wants to serve him the pudding. But Ganesha said, because he's the he knows he's a god, right? He knew that the daughter-in-law had already tasted it. So he said, well, my tummy is full now. You can keep this and distribute this as prasad to the villagers because your daughter-in-law has already tasted it and I am done. I am done. I only wanted to bless you because you were the only one who took pity on me and understood my plight. And you were kind enough to help me. And saying that, he left. So listening to this story, and that's the reason on Ganesh Chaturthi, we always make rice pudding in our house. So when my dad used to tell me this story, I was in awe. I used to feel, wow, I wish I had the magical powers of Ganesha. I wish I could hug him and cuddle him, the pot-bellied god that we have. Like this, she used to tell me more stories and more and more. So every month, there would be no day when there would, no month would ever go by when there was no story attached to one of the gods. And I just fell in love with him. After that, I started studies. I forgot, my brush with stories reduced a little bit. I was busy as a student, went to college, studied. Then I got married. When I got married, I started working into corporate. So that was the complete end to my life of being a story listener or reading stories or being in connect with stories. And no one would have ever thought, I didn't know for sure that I would ever, ever get back to storytelling or story listening. Because you get into the rigmarole of your daily chores, your routine, you're so busy, you have a family and the like. So after that, and this was in Bangalore, when I got married, I was in Bangalore. So once I was in Bangalore, I was enjoying my corporate job, 9 to 5, going back and forth, cooking, enjoying life, enjoying my time with my husband, getting to know him. And it was a very mechanical life. Just then I switched from, I was planning my family and my husband was posted into the US. So I had started working into a college, I was teaching English to third year students. It was a girls' convent college where I started teaching. And when I started teaching English and advertising, that was a time when again, I refound my love for stories. Because when you're in touch with children, they make you young, they make you live up to so many things. And they have a story, whether they want to bunk a class, whether something has happened, whether they're not submitting an assignment, they have a story to tell. And from there, we started enjoying our time of English, teaching English through stories. And that's when, again, I started getting back into reading stories about things, teaching them through the way of stories. After that, I moved back to Delhi as my husband had moved away. He was traveling out of India. I was planning my family. I became a mother of 2 beautiful daughters. They are Irish twins, so they're born a year apart. So once they were born, again, I got into the rigmarole, the daily routine of becoming a mother, taking care of my babies. And when they came up to a certain age, that's again when I started with stories. So stories have been following me and they never left me, even though I tried to leave them for some time, but they were coming back to me back and forth, back and forth. And that's when my ultimate decision of becoming a storyteller happened. Because when as a mother, you are playing the role of a storyteller, you enjoy, you enact with them, you role play with them. And my daughters grew up with those storytelling. They used to, you know, role play with me, all the stories we did, the fairy tales that I had read as a child, I was reliving it with them in their childhood. So that's how my love for stories started again. Now they are outgrown, they are into their teenage, they're on their own. They cook up stories, and they tell me, and I know some of it is true, some of it isn't. But now that I am on my own, Now I am actually into storytelling. Since I have been with stories all this while, I've now moved into professional storytelling. Thanks to the pandemic, it's been online. I mean, that's the only good thing the pandemic has done, that has brought the whole world together, and you can reach out to everybody, reach out to children all across the world, share stories with them, learn with them, see a different way of, you know, one story has so many different morals. If I have 10 students in my class, 10 morals would come from one story. So if it's one fairy tale, they bring me a different perspective, you know. So I am now learning and unlearning what stories and had meanings to me. Now I'm learning it in a different way from the students I teach and the way they see it. So that's my, in short, has been my storytelling life. So leaving a corporate life, I've moved into professional storytelling. I've established my organization, and we do a lot of work for children, teaching them stories, doing games with them, and doing a lot of activities. And it's been, there's been no looking back ever since, because we've had a very good time. So thank you so much for this platform of, you know, letting me share stories. Adult storytelling has been my first. This is my first foray into this. So you're all my seasoned seniors. So hats off to that for all of you. And I'm going to learn a lot from here. And I hope to stay connected with all of you. And this is, in short, my life of a storyteller, from what I was, from a shy introvert girl to an outspoken, blah, 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 blabbering storyteller here right in front of you. So thank you so much for your time. And thank you, Eric, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you. Now, you mentioned the other day that some of your family members didn't think it was such a good idea.
Oh, yes.
Tell us about that.
Yes. Well, first of all, your husband. thank God he's not there. He's on a call in the other room, so I can go on. Husbands really don't think storytelling as, and this is nothing against men, but, you know, they always think that storytelling as a profession, and come on, you've got to be kidding. But now he supports me in every way, and you know, he makes sure he leaves the room. I need the room now, so I said, "Out, it's my story time." Otherwise, he would just say that you go out. Storytelling, you can just do it anywhere. You can stand in the kitchen and do it. You know, why do you need a room to yourself? Why do you need a setup? So, you know, like if you see behind, I put these books and all. I like to do this nice setup with me when I'm doing my sessions with children. So he now has accepted the fact that, and over this 1 year of the pandemic, he's seen me doing sessions every day. So he has that, I found that respect from him now. So that is one. My parents have been supportive. My brother was also not that supportive. Again, he, you know, people think that, how can you just go on telling stories to people? Why would they listen to you? So I tell them that it's not about listening to me. We interact, it's interactive. And from one story, there are so many new perspectives that come out, and everybody has something to relate to the story, you know, to the character or to the meaning or to the theme in the story. So now everybody has really accepted the fact that, yes, storytelling is the in thing, and it's the best thing in the pandemic. It's brought us closer. We have stories. Everybody has a story to share, and we connect on a common platform. And they've seen the kind of work that goes in, that we put in here. In our sessions. So now everything is put to rest.
So you won them over.
Yes, finally.
Excellent, excellent.
Finally, yeah.
Yes, I also, go ahead.
Aditi, I really wish, you know, there are a lot of storytellers, but 99% of them are women. I really wish that there are men who are professional storytellers, and I can see some faces here. Yes. That would really change this, you know, notion and establish this as a profession, I think. So please, all the men, come and start telling stories professionally.
Yes, yes, yes. Agree to that completely, Surbhi. Thank you so much. We need more of them here. We need more of them. It's a female-dominated zone, I guess.
Hi, everyone. This is Manu here. And we are all a bunch of guys sitting around a tea shop, watching this wonderful session. Yeah, very, it was lovely. And we wanted to thank you for all your stories. And so we just thought, since men were mentioned, so we are all sitting at a chai tapri and enjoying these stories. Thank you so much.
What better way? Thank you for joining. Thank you.
So I think, Aditi, you should say that, you know, let more men join to listen to us, what women are talking about.
But you know, beautifully told, Aditi. Thank you so much. But you know, how is it that we are all forgetting Eric?
Oh, yes.
the founder is just absolutely, well, you're in the background, Eric.
I don't tell stories that much, and I don't work directly with children that much.
Yes.
I'm more of a coach and a facilitator.
Yeah.
So we all have our niche. But you know, there's a reason that in India the folk tales are called grandmother stories.
That's right.
They're not called grandfather stories. Because just in human society, usually it's the mother who's taking care of the very young, taking care of the very old, not getting paid for it, because yes, it's domestic work. Men, we like to become professionals and do similar work, but we like to get paid for it in a, you know, in a more public environment.
Eric, that was brilliant. But you know, that's why we call India, we call it motherland. Mm. And Germany is called Vaterland.
Okay.
I think that's the way we're grooming. Mm-hmm. So we are more of groomers, really, you know, they like Mother Earth. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, but that's so changing. But that's really changing the gender roles, aren't they? Today's men are more interested in domestic work. For example, I am now freelancing. My wife is a full-time job. And I take care of everything at home because she needs her time for work. So yeah, things are changing. And I'm currently training with Eric. There are 10 people in the group and I'm the only male there.
I happen to be a house husband these days myself. Yeah. My wife has an office outside. My office is in the guest room in our flat. So I'm more at home. Yeah. Yes, I think men are catching up. We're getting with the program.
So I'm not professional yet, I'm a storyteller myself. So.
But I think to establish storytelling as a profession in India, it would really help if men start doing it professionally. It would really raise the bar and it would not be looked like something, you know, you're just doing for children and like nurturing work. Because like Aditi pointed out, there is a lot of effort when you prepare a story, you perform. Yeah. There is a lot of effort involved. And that was just the idea behind the comment that please, I encourage all the lovely gentlemen here, please come and tell stories. Eric has such a wonderful platform that would really help all the storytellers, you know, and help us to establish it as a profession.
And very nicely said, Surabhi.
I'm sorry.
Surabhi, actually, yeah. I was just saying, like, you know, the way you said, we can ask Eric to have only men one day. For storytelling, and Aditi's husband should be the first one to know.
Oh, yes. I would make sure he attends it.
For a change, like, women will be listening and the men will be talking.
Talking, yes. Right.
No, ma'am, no gender discrimination.
Yeah, sorry. Even I agree. I say that.
No gender discrimination. All are equal. All are equal.
No, absolutely. This is such good fun. But, you know, we look at the men and their perspective. It'll be so different. You know, it'll be so beautiful. Like, you know, one of them just came up and said, okay, he's domesticated now. But, you know, we'd still like to know what exactly, how they think, why they think. The way they think, you know, it'll be really a lovely amalgamation of, you know. So we look forward to that. Yes, young man.
Yes, I also agree with Kalyan when he says that, you know, there is things are changing now. And, you know, earlier there were certain professions just meant for female, like the nursing, like the teaching, like, you know, there were so many things. But it also depends on what a person wants to do. There are so many females who are doing such wonderful job in the corporate, and like we have Sanjeev Kapoor, who is doing an excellent work as a chef, and so many of them, not just one. So things are changing. It is what you want to do with heart, and what you connect, what resonates with you. And the whole idea about story is not just story as a story. It is much, much more to it.
Well said, Mom.
Yeah, well said. I think why you would find fewer men telling stories is that stories by nature need you to be connected to them. You need to empathize. You need to get emotionally involved with that story. And as men, that is a very, very hard thing to do. I'm sure you all know that.
Hard to accept.
You know why, Kalyan? You know why?
Accept.
You know why, Kalyan? Kalyan, you know why? Yeah. Because you don't want to expose your, you know, there is a part of you which is your subconscious mind, and probably, you know, you don't want to expose too much of that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we are entirely different. Look at women. We connect anytime we meet. I mean, across borders, across age groups, we just connect and we'll talk as though we've known each other since years. Men can never do that. You know, so they need to, like what Meenakshi and all of us are sharing it. Surbhi began very well, I think, you know, Aditi, I mean, you explained that so well. I think we should sort of promote the men also coming out. And you know what really I feel, Kalyan, is the main thing? You become a good listener.
Yeah.
You know, coming to this platform, I've just joined. Don't look at the gray, but I've just joined in, and I feel there's so much to take away. You know, we as a community, we all really reach out to each other, and it's beautiful. I mean, thanks, Eric. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, all of you.
Yes, storytelling is not just about telling stories. Yeah. It's also about the discussion that happens after the storytelling, and the you know, the training and the coaching that one gives to young people or teachers. So it's a very it's a field that involves a lot of conversation and discussing details and becoming more articulate about details regarding to performance, regarding to the story, regarding to feelings. So men can do that, but you know, if you go to any literature department at any college, it's 90% women. So women tend to be more interested, whether it's in the genes or culturally defined, women do tend to gravitate towards this sort of work.
Yes.
But we're catching up. Okay, thank you so much, Aditi. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
And this has been the April 2021 session of Storytelling by and for Adults. The recordings will go up on our YouTube situation. And okay, so you're all getting emails, obviously, because you got the Zoom thing. So you'll hear about the Chennai Storytelling Festival next February and everything else. Okay, shall we say goodnight? Does anyone else want to say anything? It's enough?
Thank you, Eric, once again for arranging all this.
Thank you so much.
Great.
Thank you,